All right, everyone, we're going to go ahead and get started with our next speaker. I've got the pleasure of introducing someone who's a close friend and mentor of mine, and she's also a proud cat mom. She wanted me to announce that for her, Kara Zupkus. Kara currently serves as the spokeswoman of Young America's Foundation. Hailing originally from Wadsworth, Illinois, Kara graduated from the George Washington University with a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science with a minor in Journalism and Mass Communications. Kara became involved with Young America's Foundation her freshman year at the George Washington University in Washington, D.C. She served on the chapter's executive board for 4 years and successfully hosted Ben Shapiro at a standing room only event and amid controversy while serving as the GWEF co-president her senior year. The chapter also hosted Senators Rick Santorum and Rand Paul, among other speakers, in addition to participating in YAF's 9/11 Never Forget Project, Freedom Week, and Cemetery of the Innocent activism events. During her time at GW, Kara interned through YAF's National Journalism Center and was placed at NBC News' Washington Bureau. Kara also worked for the Washington Examiner and America Action Forum before joining YAF's National Headquarters staff. And in 2020, Kara was profiled in Newsweek as a young, diverse conservative star, progressive Zena Fear. Please join me in welcoming Kara Zupkus.
What a wonderful intro. Thanks so much. I'm excited to speak to you guys today. As Blake mentioned, I got involved in YAF in college, so you guys are already way ahead of me. Getting involved in high school is really awesome, and I'm going to go through today how you can defend your First Amendment rights when they're being infringed upon by your administrators. They might already be being infringed upon by your high school teachers and things like that. So we're going to go through today how you can defend yourself, how you can expose different campus bias incidents that are happening at your school, and the resources that YAF has to help defend your rights as a student. Okay, so I do have a few prizes to give out for people that can kind of keep it engaged and answer some questions that I have. So who wants to tell me what are the five freedoms that the First Amendment protects? Yes. Yes, good job. Good go. Catch. Woo! Oh, man. I promise I'm better at speaking than I am throwing. Sad. Yeah, so that's absolutely right. So those are kind of the core freedoms that are protected by the First Amendment. And I really want to make sure that you guys understand those and kind of recognize what that means and what school administrators are expected when you go to these schools and how they can protect that. So there are a bunch of different ways that schools can violate your rights. And a lot of times it can be outwardly, they're very obviously doing it, and a lot of times it can be very passive. And you kind of have to do some digging to figure out what exactly is going on. So one way that schools can violate your rights is by discriminatory treatment. So let's say if you are starting a YAF chapter on campus, you want to bring a speaker like Ben Shapiro to your campus. And if you have to go through your student government to get funding for that, let's say you apply for $10,000 to bring Ben Shapiro, and your student government denies you with some weird reason saying, oh, it's not going to be a successful event, but it's not necessarily outwardly biased. They're kind of just giving you some off-the-cuff answer. If you can do some digging and find out what other student organizations who have gone in front of student governments with similar proposals have gotten, and see if there's kind of a discrepancy there with the funding that you're getting, you can also kind of do some research into who the people on your student governments are. A lot of times they are, of course, dominated by liberals, so do some digging, see if there's tweets maybe criticizing the speaker that you are trying to bring on campus. See if they've said awful things about conservatives and kind of bring that to their attention and maybe bring that to their supervisor's attention. Usually there's a administrator that oversees student governments. Really kind of get into the nitty-gritty and show them that, hey, I'm being treated differently just because of my views, and that, of course, cannot be tolerated. And in a little bit later, we'll go into how it differs between private schools and public schools. But specifically, you want to make sure that you're realizing how similar student organizations of similar size are bringing speakers and what kind of money they're getting and the treatment that they're getting from administrators. Another way that schools can violate your rights is by banning speech under the guise of inclusivity. How many of you guys have kind of a school that promotes this idea of DEI, which is diversity, equity, and inclusion. Yes, so that's often where we see, most recently now, with critical race theory being pushed on these campuses, sometimes as young as high school or even elementary, and they really do try to shut down your speech under the guise of, oh, you're not being inclusive enough. So let's say you have a traditional view on what marriage is between a man and a woman. They can try to shut you down and say, oh, well, that's homophobic. That's not allowed on our campus because you need to be welcoming and inclusive to everyone. That is violating your constitutional right as a student to have your opinion and to have your speech on campus. And if you ever are facing a situation like that, please let YAF know, and we're happy to come help to your aid there, because that cannot be tolerated on campuses. A lot of times, as we mentioned earlier with Jacob at College of Lake County, when they were hosting a speech on transgenderism and how it really just kind of weakens the definition of what a woman is. Luckily, the school didn't actually put up roadblocks to hosting the event, but if they had, under the guise of it being not inclusive to transgenders, if it's transphobic, what have you, that absolutely would have been a case where YAF could enter and potentially pursue litigation for First Amendment abuses. Another way that schools can violate your rights is penalizing students for speaking out. I think of one case last year at Iowa State University where this actually came through our tip line and it caused a huge stir. A professor at Iowa State put on her syllabus, giant warning, and she had it like bolded. She was like, there will be no instances of ableism, homophobia, racism, like what have you, all the leftist buzzwords that they love to put. And then she said, you are not allowed to express pro-life or anti-BLM views in my classroom or you will be expelled from the class. Which, okay, on it, like, hello, that's blatantly a violation of the First Amendment. So we immediately wrote a story about that. We contacted the school, and I think within 24 hours, the syllabus had been fixed, and about 2 or 3 months later, the Iowa State Board of Regents pursued and installed a free speech policy where every single class has to put on their syllabus in the public school system that you kind of recognize free speech, and that the free speech policy that the school has is going to be instituted in your classroom. So again, a huge win for YAF there. And again, that's just one way through the media. Potentially, if they hadn't changed it, we probably could have pursued litigation. But again, penalizing students for speaking out, you can't be penalized for having pro-life views or speaking out against the Marxist Black Lives Matter movement. That's totally unconstitutional. So those are kind of some ways, again, very blatantly, like this last example, or very kind of passively, that they might be treating you differently based on your views. So as I mentioned earlier, there are kind of two different routes here. So raise your hand if you go to a public school. Okay, cool. So it looks like maybe half, three quarters. So public schools, there's definitely a lot more leeway for YAF to get involved there, especially in the legal realm, because as a being a public school, it is essentially a government-run school, and therefore they are required to abide by the U.S. Constitution. So a lot of ways that we can get involved in making sure that your rights aren't being infringed upon is a FOIA. And who can tell me what a FOIA is, what it stands for, and what it means? In the back. Mm-hmm. Good job. You want a shirt or a signed book?
Signed book.
Okay, you can get it after then. It's Newt Gingrich. Do you know, who can tell me what a Freedom of Information Act request is? Yes. Sorry, a little louder? Yes, good job. Let's see what I have. Okay, gonna be better this time, I promise. Okay, cool. Close enough. It's fine. So if you didn't hear what she said it's where you can kind of see what your children are learning by filing requests with the school. You can see kind of the curriculum and different emails. That's something that YAF here often utilizes. We have an awesome legal team who can file Freedom of Information Act requests to really see what's going on behind closed doors. We've often seen it kind of increasingly with critical race theory, actually getting the documents that are being taught to children as young as preschool. What's on the recommended reading list? Is it pushing a transgender BLM agenda? What are these teachers emailing back and forth about YAF chapters kind of behind closed doors? And the funny part is a lot of times administrators and teachers don't even realize that their emails are public records. And I'll go into a case about that later that YAF actually encountered, where we received instant messages and things like that. And they just really have no idea that all of that can be obtained by anyone in the public, really. So if you do kind of have an inkling that something is going on at your school that's a little bit shady, let YAF know. We're happy to file a FOIA request on your behalf to really see what's going on there. So once we kind of see that inside look, the next step is potentially litigation if there is a blatant violation of your First Amendment rights here. Now, litigation is often the very last step that we would want to take because obviously that's very costly. It's very long process. So before we get to kind of that process, we do want to try to solve it through maybe administrative meetings, through press, putting pressure on the school, those things. But if we do need to go to litigation, YAF absolutely will. We're currently involved in two cases, which I will show you guys about. We've also won recent cases. Someone in this room, Luke Wong, we threatened litigation at his school, at Harrison High School, because they were trying to not allow his YAF chapter, and we ended up pushing back against the school, and now he does have a YAF chapter, which is super awesome, and we didn't need to go to the full court realm. But there have been some cases, and I'll show you guys, I'm sure you've heard about UC Berkeley, where YAF was involved. We've sued the University of Florida. Right now we're suing SUNY Binghamton and University of Minnesota. So we're really not afraid to get involved there if that's what it takes to stand up for students. Another way that public schools kind of have, a better way to get involved compared to private schools is involving lawmakers, because obviously congressional representatives are super interested about what's going on in their district specifically. So YAF is not afraid to let them know, hey, this instance is going on. Are you going to do anything about it? And sometimes as simple as a letter from a congressman to a school can really scare the bejeebies out of an administrator. So definitely we involve them when we can. And something that's actually really cool that YAF just started is our free speech caucus. Have you guys heard about that? Okay, awesome. So if you're not familiar, YAF just started a free speech caucus in the House of Representatives with Representative Jim Jordan and Kat Kamick. And essentially it's going to be a direct line for lawmakers to hear about what's going on the campuses, high school, college, what have you. They're going to meet monthly with YAF leaders and students to really hear about what's going on. I think there's about 40 members of Congress that have joined so far. So again, really being able to involve and sway these schools into making the right decision. Okay, so the next video I'm going to show you guys, there is some swearing in it, so I want to give you a warning. If you're not comfortable with that, you can step out. It's like a couple F-bombs. But this is a case that we are currently embroiled in at SUNY Binghamton. How many of you guys are familiar with that case? A couple of you? Okay, cool. So the video will give you some more information, but essentially YAF hosted Dr. Arthur Laffer at the State University of New York, Binghamton. And a few days before the event, the leftists on campus protested people tabling for it, mobbed them with about 200 people, and you'll see the mob with, that's where all the swearing is, forcing them to shut down their table and being like, you go away, you don't belong here. And then the day of the event with Dr. Laffer was shut down by the same leftist protesters because the administrators refused to make any preparations with security and essentially just allowed them to censor Dr. Laffer's and YAF's speech. So we'll go ahead and show you that video. I don't think there's volume. I don't know if we can fix that. I think we're having volume issues. Sorry, we're just gonna see if we can fix it. Wanna make sure you guys are able to hear the crazy mob. It's like the best part. I sifted through like hours of footage of this like tabling. Honestly, it went on for about an hour and a half to 2 hours of these. It was like four conservative students just standing at a table and like getting mobbed by, the mob just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It was really insane. And kudos, I mean, these are gonna be some great examples of students that are really brave for standing up to the mob.
Why are you shaking? Smile more. Smile more. Look at the teeth.
Talking about Art Laffer, he's the former Reagan administration official, and he was shut down by protesters when he was trying to speak. Listen.
We are tired of being oppressed, and we are tired of getting murdered by this administration. Because of this, we will mention the stories of all the lives lost through the administration that you, this man, this liar, Art Laffer supports.
I don't think I had anything controversial to say whatsoever. What they did was they just don't like the organization, the Young Republicans. They don't like the sponsor, which was Young America's Foundation, which was founded by two great friends and mentors of mine, Bill Buckley and Ronald Reagan.
Did you get to speak at all?
No, I did not. I just got up there at the podium to speak, and then this young man jumped up with a bullhorn and started reading. He didn't even know my last name.
So that is a little bit of an insight as to what those students were facing on campus. And obviously, the administrators knew that that was going to happen. They were given tips about a huge protest happening, and they really did not make any preparations to do so. We requested that they would reserve a different room for the protesters to peacefully and be able to have their First Amendment rights. Because, of course, if you disagree with the speaker, you're allowed to protest. But where that fine line is you're not allowed to shut down someone else's speech, because then you are infringing on the rights of the speaker and the organization that put on that program to hear the speech. So obviously, we are currently embroiled in a lawsuit against not only the student groups who assembled that mass protest, but also the administrators who sat by and did nothing, the police force who sat back and did nothing, and instead of taking out the protesters, they took out Dr. Laffer, and the speech didn't happen, and that's not okay. So this is another example of how YAF is really going to defend your rights. If you were to put on a speech like this and something happened with your YAF chapter or another group on campus, we'd be happy to help really make sure that everything goes smoothly, and if not, we're going to be there to put the pressure on the administrator. So that's something that we're currently embroiled in. And then I want to show you another video of our UC Berkeley lawsuit, which was a few years ago, and this was, of course, with Ben Shapiro and other conservative speakers visiting Berkeley. They wanted to levy these huge security fees and really try to limit the attendance of the programs because leftists at UC Berkeley are very liberal and didn't want to hear those conservative speakers. So here's a little bit about that.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. The only way they can inherit the freedom we have known is if we fight for it, protect it, defend it, and then hand it to them with the well-taught lessons of how they in their lifetime must do the same.
Very often what you have is protesters determined to shut down an event, and college administrators, instead of stopping that, is they change their policies to allow the students to actually engage in this sort of anti-free speech activity.
For speakers who are quote-unquote controversial, and guess what, on the Berkeley campus.
That wasn't good. Oh, my. Sorry for your ears. Yeah, I was kind of expecting me to do the same. Scared to push the play button. Okay. Oh, now there's no sound. Well, we can come back to this video if they figure out the sound, because it's a really cool video and it kind of shows you guys just the level of media that was really the level of media that was required to really push the school into making the right decision. And eventually, as you'll see in the video, once we can get it playing again, YAF did win this lawsuit. The school decided to settle. Not only did they pay us back our legal fees, but they ended up changing the policy on the books so that future student organizations on campus don't have to deal with that, because it's absurd and no student should have to jump through the loops and the holes that these students did on campus just to be able to bring someone that shares the same perspective as them, because that is crazy. So I think we'll go back to this video later if we can. So those are kind of the options that I mentioned with public schools, but with private schools it's very different, because as a private company, essentially a private institution, they are not required, sadly, to abide by the First Amendment. So the options for litigation there are definitely very limited and or just non-existent. Sometimes if you can get a little bit creative, you can kind of challenge them on their own rules on the books and their student code of conduct and things like that, but it's not necessarily something that you can litigate about. You can definitely challenge them, maybe send a couple scary threatening letters, but it's not necessarily something that can go to court. You also can't FOIA them. I went to a private school, George Washington University. I would have loved to FOIA the administrators that I had to deal with. I'm sure they were calling me awful names behind my back, trying to bring Ben Shapiro and people like that, but you can't FOIA them. Their emails and their documents are not a public record because they are not a government institution. So really the only route to go when you're facing First Amendment abuses at these private schools is the public relations route, which is something that I'm here at YAF very familiar with. It's something that we do often for YAF chapters that are getting revoked or not recognized by private schools. You can see on the screen here, Santa Clara University was a chapter that was trying to get recognized. They were denied three times by the student government, citing that it would be emotionally abusive to students on campus and like citing Ben Shapiro as being a hateful person. So basically really injecting their personal politics into the decision, which of course at a public school, easy First Amendment lawsuit right there. You can't discriminate on political views and speech. But because it was a private school, we didn't really have a lot of options. So we did a PR campaign, call to action on Facebook, you know, rile up all the people on and the masses on our social media. YAF has a huge social media following to really contact the school and put the pressure on the administrator, the dean, to overturn the student government's decision, which eventually they did. We finally, I think maybe like two semesters after trying and trying and trying, the chapter was finally able to get recognized. The student government wasn't very happy that the dean overruled their decision, but we kind of held them to their own free speech ideals in their student code of conduct. Hey, we promote free speech on campus, then why aren't you? You know, like kind of the hypocrisy there. Another institution at the University of Pennsylvania, it was a CR chapter on campus trying to host Dinesh D'Souza. 2 days before the event, I was scheduled to go there to Philly. They revoked the venue for the event, saying it wasn't going to be safe with security, basically offering them a different room that had maybe like 200 to 300 less seats than the original room was scheduled and proposed. So they had been advertising it as being in this room for weeks and weeks and weeks, and now 2 days before, the university is basically trying to pull the plug on the event. And they also said that people from the public weren't allowed to attend. They had to have a student ID card to be able to attend. So obviously limiting the audience there. So again, we ran a PR campaign. I actually got the email of the lady who made that decision, and she probably still hates me to this day, but we did a public relations campaign, like call to action, email her, and like we did like paid advertising, and she just got slammed with emails, and she was like, please take down your ad, and I was like, please change your mind, and she was like, no, so I was like, no, it's not gonna happen. So it was just an ongoing battle there. Eventually, we were able to secure an agreeable venue that was bigger than the one that they had originally suggested. Again, they didn't revoke the ban to the public, which was really frustrating because a lot of people were wanting to come from the public, you know, that are fans of Dinesh D'Souza that maybe aren't students at an Ivy League school. So that was a little bit frustrating, but we still packed the room, full crowd, and we were able to live tweet out tweets and pictures like that. There were protesters at the event, but they weren't like the SUNY Binghamton video where it like really shut it down. They sat in the back with a bunch of signs and like duct tape over their mouths. It was really dramatic. But the event went on without a hitch, so it was really great. And again, just another way that we can do that PR route to put pressure on the school and really get the average citizen involved. I think there's a lot of people in the conservative movement today who might just be like parents, or they might not even have children, but they want to feel like they're making a difference, and they don't really know how to do that. So I think that's a really great way that we can activate those students, parents of students, those grandparents of students, just your regular concerned citizen, and help them feel like they're actually making a difference, which is cool. So if you are facing something like this, there are a few ways that you can go about changing what's happening at your school, whether it's private or public, if we decide to go the press route. So the first thing is getting your story in the national news. And now that might sound really scary to someone who's like out of high school. And you're like, I don't want to like get in trouble with my administrators. I just want to like graduate and go on with my life. But it really does take kind of a bold student to want to tackle that. And I think it's really rewarding for students, and you can really set an example and inspire others. It really just takes kind of one person to kind of get the ball rolling and be like, oh, well, if he can do it, I can do it. So if we write something that comes through our campus bias tip line, we have so many media contacts in conservative media. It regularly gets aggregated by like Daily Wire, Daily Caller, all the conservative news outlets. And then from there, we also focus our efforts on getting in local news, because while, yes, it's awesome to get national media, a lot of times what it's going to cause to take the change is getting local media, get your local radio host talking about it. So people on the ground are being like, what is happening at my school? I had no idea. And then that, in turn, can help reform the school, putting the pressure on them to reform their discriminatory decisions. And then also, it just kind of highlights what it's like to be a conservative on campus. I think you guys are in a really unique position. Obviously, there's always so much talk about what it's like to be a conservative on campus, but it's really hard to find people willing to talk about it. So you guys are in a really unique position, and I think a lot of people would value hearing from you directly. So that's super important. It just, again, just take one person in here to kind of spark that movement. So I definitely recommend, if you're facing any kind of bias, to let us know, and I'll go through in a little bit how you can contact us and help YAF get involved in reforming the decision. So we went over this a little bit before. So the Freedom of Information Act request obviously helps us kind of get an inside look into when we think something suspicious is going on. And I want to talk about a story that I mentioned earlier with the instant messages. So one of our former interns, he was interning here just in the summer, like these interns were. His name is Parker Bowman. And he was trying for months to start a YAF chapter at the University of Kentucky. And he just was getting stonewalled. They were like, oh, like, we're still figuring it out. We're doing the paperwork, like, really just trying to delay him. So our general counsel, once he was talking to Parker about it, was like, well, let's file a FOIA request, like, see what's going on. So we got back, within a couple of days, hundreds of emails and instant messages, which I had no idea instant messages were covered in a FOIA, which was, like, pretty cool. It was like a G-chat. And you could see these two administrators in the student services office talking about why they were delaying his chapter from being formed. And they were saying, oh, this kid is going to be so mad. We waited forever just to deny him, LOL, like really mocking this student. And they were like, oh, Jesus, tap dancing Christ, this kid is back again bothering us, like really just mocking this student. And it was very embarrassing for them. So we ran that story, just publishing all of their messages that really show that that anger and that resistance to start the chapter based on, again, their political views and not wanting him to be able to express his views on campus. So we published it. We reached out to the university for comment. It was literally so embarrassing for the school. Like, so many local media outlets covered it. There were, like, local TV stations interviewing Parker. And the university was really on the defensive there, which is always where you want them to be. They have to be able to defend their actions. And, of course, they weren't, because that's unconstitutional. So immediately they said, we're so sorry for the delay. The employees will be reprimanded, and we will immediately grant recognition to his chapter, which was great. And he ended up hosting Michael Knowles, I think, that fall, and like a standing room only audience. So again, sometimes FOIAs really do kind of provide that insight as to what exactly is going on. And that really can be kind of the kickstarter into further litigation or a PR campaign, which can be really helpful to YAF. Another FOIA that we did recently at the University of Kentucky again, we got a campus bias tip there that resident assistants were being forced to participate in segregated trainings. So black students were forced to go in one group, and then white students were forced to go in another. And as you can imagine, at the white one, it was like, here's why you should be guilty about, why you should feel guilty about being white. Here's how you should help your oppressed peers. And then the black space was talking about how oppressed they were, which, hello, segregation ended like many years ago. Why are we going back to that? It's very messed up. So again, we published that. We got the documents. We're still actually getting the documents from that and continuing to publish ongoing stories afterwards. But the school, again, super embarrassed. They said this should never have happened. It will not happen again, and kind of gave the employees a talking to that hosted those events. So FOIAs really do kind of give us that inside look, which is really helpful. So going back to the tip line, over the last 2 years, we've exposed over 200 stories that have really reformed on different campuses. And again, you can go to yaf.org/tips if you guys are facing bias and you want to submit something, or you can go and look at that map. We have different columns on there as well. So if you want to reach out to an administrator, we have an action still needed column where you can like directly contact a school and really push them to change their decision. We have a exposed column, which is where the school didn't necessarily take action, but they were still really embarrassed and like said something about it, which is kind of a win, but like we still want them to go the extra mile. And then we have a resolved column where we've actually seen real change. So that's like, again, the University of Kentucky, Iowa State, where they instilled free speech training. What are some other ones? So Elon University and University of Florida, again, we're both holding these segregated spaces. I don't know why this is like such a trend all of a sudden, like segregating students, but calling them out, exposing them, making them super embarrassed, putting them on the defensive, and quickly they changed their minds. I think Elon was holding like a whites only guilt like session. So it was literally like saying in the title, like whites only in an email to students. And then saying like, you need to come talk about how racist you are. Like that is so messed up. And then again, Harrison High School with Luke Wong, he came to us and we were able to expose that and luckily get him a chapter before having to go to full litigation. We did have to get lawyers involved and kind of put pressure on the school. But again, we were able to get that action that we wanted, which was great. So why does all of this matter? Like, why do we care that students are facing bias? Why should we care that First Amendment rights are being violated? And this actually is a stat from a recent poll that we did, that 46% of high school and college students have stated that they've stopped themselves from sharing their ideas or opinions in the classroom. And 41% of students didn't share their opinions out of fear of offending a classmate. So again, if schools are pushing this kind of intense environment where no dissenting opinions are allowed, of course you're going to be scared to speak out. If you feel like your teacher is going to mark you down on an assignment because you view something differently than them, of course you're not going to want to speak out. So this is why it's so important that we continually expose and call them out, because otherwise no one else will. You know, the regular people in the mainstream media aren't going to do that. It's really up to the conservatives to call them out and hold their feet to the fire, as we say. So there's a few ways beyond exposing campus bias, how you guys can actually pursue and further freedom's message on your campuses. And of course, as you guys have been hearing, the biggest way to do this is starting a YAF chapter. I can't express this enough. There's so many cool ways that you can really get involved, whether it's like hosting a different speaker on campus, doing an activism project like the 9/11 Never Forget Project, which registration is open now if you're interested in doing that. With the 9/11 Never Forget Project, you actually don't even have to be in a YAF chapter. You can just be a YAF individual member and reserve space on your campus or your local community. So definitely go ahead and register for that if you can. It's going to be the 20th anniversary. And I'm sure a lot of schools just kind of don't do anything for it, or they don't really make it a priority as it should be. So it's really up to you guys to make sure that that gets put on. And then again, activism projects like the pro-life timeline, Freedom Week, commemorating the fall of the Berlin Wall, doing letters to veterans, all of those things to present that conservative viewpoint on your campus that probably otherwise just wouldn't be heard. Those are all really great ways to do that. It's also important to control your messaging. A lot of times it can be easy to get convoluted, especially on social media these days, and just be about all owning the libs and not really like having your principle. So I think it's important. A lot of times I'll refer back to YAF's founding document, which is a Sharon statement, really centering on the principles of free enterprise, traditional family values, individual freedom, strong national defense. It's really important to control your messaging and make sure that people understand what it means to be a conservative, so that they're not just believing what the mainstream media is telling them what conservatives are, that, oh, opposing critical race theory means you're a racist, because that's not at all what that means. So this is going to be a little bit more specifics on how you guys can market freedom. This can be specifically with YAF chapters or your own personal social media. Specifically, one thing I like to use is called Canva. Have you guys heard of Canva? Okay, it's literally so easy to use. I actually made this presentation with Canva. So it's, I promise I'm like not this artistic. It like had a free like templates and everything. It was great. So if you have no artistic ability like me, it's really easy. They have hundreds of pre-made templates, stock images that you can use. They have an app and a web version as well. And they also have pre-sized formats because, you know, like an Instagram post isn't the same size as a Twitter post, and Facebook gets all confusing. That's actually what we use for all of YAF's social media content as well, so it's super easy to make. And the important thing to focus on is, what do students care about at your school? Maybe you go to a more conservative school, or maybe you go to a school where people just don't talk about politics, they hate it, they think it's a waste of time. So you really need to focus on what they care about. So let's say you go to a school with a big football team, like that's like super what's big, everyone loves the football team, it's great. So how can you kind of center your messaging around what people care about? So maybe it's hosting the 9/11 Never Forget Project outside of the football stadium before a game. So everyone can see you, you can invite them to put a flag in, and then, hey, you can hand them a little brochure about joining YAF. It might sound like kind of weird, like how could you involve those things? But it really does just kind of take that creative thinking. Specifically, when I attended GW, there was a big push about changing the mascot on campus because they thought the colonial was racist. I'm like, why would you attend George Washington University? But that's another story. So the YAF chapter there hosted Michael Knowles, and they did all of their advertising for Michael Knowles around the idea of changing the mascot and canceling the founding fathers and revisionist history, because that's what people cared about. And then they had a standing room only event. Maybe people didn't know who Michael Knowles was, but they cared about the topic enough to come out and hear the other side and debate Michael Knowles. So it's very important to be in tune with what people at your school care about. So here's a sample flyer that I help students with to get them to do the 9/11 Never Forget Project. If you hang this around school, it's like boom in your face, will you remember? And they're like, What am I remembering? Did I forget something? And then they go and they're like, oh, okay, remember the lives lost on 9/11. So that really does capture their attention. And you really only have a few seconds to grab someone's attention if they're like scrolling on social media or walking through the hallways. They're really inundated with different messages. So it's important to grab their attention right away with a quick, simple message. Quick question to really like get them drawn in with a nice picture, really easy to read font and everything. And of course, if you are promoting for your YAF chapter, having that Young Americans for Freedom logo, just so you can kind of keep that branding similar. So generally I want to touch on social media and then I'll open it up to you guys for questions. So it is important, obviously nowadays in social media, everyone is on it, but it's important that you are careful with what you say. Again, owning the libs is fun, but you always kind of want to think about things that whatever you tweet will be around forever. So think about when you're applying for a job after college in 5 years, like would an employer be okay with you tweeting that? Does this kind of align with my principles of traditional values, of strong national defense, free enterprise? So always just kind of be careful. It might be fun to just like dunk on people all the time, like for retweets and likes and things like that. But at the end of the day, you should be making sure that you're focusing on promoting what you're for and not necessarily what you're against all the time, really pushing those values. And I think a lot of times leftists are on the hunt to cancel people, and you don't want to kind of give them the fuel for that fire. So just make sure you're careful, not to like sound like your mom, but just be careful about what you post. It could come back to bite you. Sometimes I recommend just like checking your Twitter like once a year, just making sure that everything you tweeted a year ago is still kind of held to the same values that you hold today. Because a lot of times conservatives are held to a higher standard than liberals, which is unfair, but that's kind of the reality of the situation. And we always have to be ready to kind of defend ourselves from any kind of attacks. So here's a little bit of information on how you can contact us. That's our Freedom Hotline here at headquarters, 1-800-USA-1776. So you can call us whenever during business hours. You can ask to talk to me or one of our other amazing staff members here. We're happy to answer any questions you have. Again, there's that URL, yaf.org/tips. You can submit instances of bias, share it with your other friends, family members. That's my personal email, so if you guys have any questions, feel free to contact me. And then that's my Twitter handle as well. If there's something you want us to retweet from YAF or something like that, I'm happy to share it. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions, campus bias, my experience as a conservative, how to market things, literally whatever you guys want, throw it at me. I'm ready. Let's do it.
If you have a question, come line up over here, say your name and where you go to school.
Hi, my name's Ani and I go to Burbank High School in Burbank, California. And I helped start a YAF chapter at my school this year. And so I was just wondering if you had any like general advice on how to grow the chapter.
Yeah. Is that the school with the banned books
yeah.
and everything? Okay, I remember that. That was exciting. So I think that could be something that you capitalize on definitely still reaching out to people about the banned books. For those of you who aren't familiar, she attends a school where the administration essentially banned some classic books. Was it like To Kill a Mockingbird, some other books, because they were offensive. So YAF ran a banned books campaign to donate books to all the students that wanted them so they could still read them. But I think that would be a great way to get people involved. I think generally just posting flyers that make you sound fun, youthful, hip. I mean, I'm kind of youthful and hip sometimes, but you probably have a better idea than me of what excites high school students. Definitely outreach on social media. I think Instagram is really the biggest platform that everyone is on. So create an Instagram page for your chapter. Follow people that you know are conservative at the school or who you think might be a closet conservative. See if they follow you back. And then if they do, shoot them a message. Hey, we're meeting at this time and this day. Come hang out and see what we're all about. You can also invite potentially nice liberals, so you know, maybe won't necessarily try to shut down your meeting, but we'll have an actual dialogue with you. And then from there, once you kind of get your core membership, from there you can start hosting the different activism events on campus. I think the 9/11 project would be a great way to have little cards handing out with club information. And then from there, potentially hosting a speaker as well. I know it's a little bit different with high school versus college for speakers, but I think definitely gain your kind of core group of people, even if it's like five people, that's totally enough to kind of go out on campus and spread the message. And then from there, begin hosting different events to draw more people in.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Avon from Miami and St. Brendan High School. I started a chapter this year with YAF, but I've been denied like six times. So what do you recommend?
Oh, wow. Is it a public school?
It's a Catholic school.
Okay. So definitely reach out to me over email with all of your documentation and everything, and we can take a look. It is a little bit harder because it's private, but there's definitely a case that we can make specifically if your school has something in their mission statement or their student code of conduct about promoting academic freedom and freedom of speech. That's something that we can kind of key in on and be like, hey, why are you denying this group? They meet all of your requirements. What's exactly the reasoning going on there? And we could potentially work with you to write a letter to the school, take the administrative route, or from there, if that doesn't work, go the PR campaign, if that's something that you'd be comfortable with.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Lily Ficassi. I go to Fauquier High School here in Virginia. And so you gave us a lot of examples of really big things. And my school did deal when we had that speaker and there was a whole issue with that. But do you want us to come with to you with like the small things, like with a comment a teacher makes? Or is that not what you're here for? Like, how big does it have to be to come and reach out to you?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it can be anything as so long as you have documentation to prove it. So I think a lot of times students face biased teachers in the classroom, but the class isn't necessarily recorded or they don't have it on like a PowerPoint with like a nasty comment. So it's kind of a he said, she said case, which there it's kind of we're stuck because we can't necessarily publish a story on he said, she said. So if it's something like a teacher makes a comment and it's a Zoom class and it's recorded and you have that recording, definitely send it to us, and that's something that we can potentially use. If it's something like being denied a flyer, a lot of times what we will ask students to do is to get your administrators and your teachers on the record. So email them. Let's say you have like a nice conversation with them in person on why they denied your flyer. So then later that day you email them being like, hey, thanks for the meeting. I just wanted to clarify. Can you explain why you denied me the flyer? And then that way, if we can get it in writing, boom, there we go. We can run a story on that. So a lot of times they'll try and finagle their way around that because they know of organizations like us that report on stuff like that. So a lot of times they'll just be like, hey, do you want another meeting? And you're like, no, I can't meet. Can you just explain over email? So really push them to get that in writing. Once it's in writing, we can really go far with that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Charles Hayworth from Ravenscroft, Raleigh, North Carolina. And something funny has happened to me this year, and I joined YAF this year. And the only email I've gotten from my chapter is, okay, go to this to join YAF and all that stuff. And we haven't had meetings or anything, so how could I get my YAF chapter to actually have meetings?
That's very frustrating. If the chapter is kind of like defunct or not really doing anything, we'd be happy to help you connect with the leadership. We have a spreadsheet of contact information for all of the chapter chairs. So if you're not happy and satisfied with how frequently or unfrequently the chapter is meeting, we can potentially put you in contact with them to discuss if they just don't have the time to run the chapter, or maybe turning it over to you or someone else that's more dedicated and passion filled, because we don't want you to be stuck, like, there's a YAF chapter, so I can't start another one, but they don't do anything. Like, we'll definitely help remedy that situation. That's not a problem.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks, guys.